Turn with me, if you would please, to the book of Proverbs, the 21st chapter. We'll be reading from the New King James Version. Proverbs chapter 21 is where we will find our opening text this morning. How many are thankful for the Word of God? Proverbs chapter 21 and verse number 1. Now we're going to talk about some things today. And so how many promise that you're not going to get mad at Pastor Steve? You still love me? Okay. We'll take another survey at the end of the message and see how many. No. I believe you love me, and I believe you'll look over all my shortcomings and downfalls, and then you know how my wife feels all the time, right? Proverbs chapter 21, verse number 1, says the king's heart. Everybody say the king's heart. Or here in America, we would say the president's heart. The king's heart or the president's heart is in the hand of who? It's in the hand of the Lord. As the rivers of water, and he, the Lord, turns it whithersoever he will. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful, beautiful Lord's Day that you've given us. Lord, I just thank you that you have brought us here safe and sound. You've given us another week. Lord, I thank you for touching my body. Lord, I was not able to be here last Sunday. I just thank you for that healing touch. Lord, as we come to this most sacred time where we break forth the word of life, Father, just anoint our ears to hear, anoint our eyes to see. Father, just hide me behind the cross. May I speak only what you would have me to say. We thank you for what you've done and what you're doing and what you're about to do. And we give you all the praise and honor and glory in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen, amen. And amen. Let me mention quickly, we bypassed our communion service last Sunday, so we will have communion next Sunday. And then starting thereafter, we will make communion available at the table every Sunday for those who so desire. And so join us next Sunday morning for a corporate time of communion service. And then there, starting after that, communion will be available every Sunday morning at your desire during worship as you see fit. Once again, it says, the king's heart or the president's heart is in the hand of the Lord as the rivers of water, and he, not the king, not the president, but the Lord. Everybody say the Lord. The Lord turns it whithersoever he will. The title of our message this morning is this, and as soon as you hear it, you're going to know where we're going. No matter who is president, God is still on the throne. Can somebody say praise the Lord? No matter who is president, God is still on the throne. Aren't you thankful for that fact this morning? Amen. Now, this statement is almost an oxymoron because it's true and it really doesn't matter who's president. But on the other hand, can I tell you it does matter? It does matter. But ultimately, in the whole scheme of things, we must remember that God is in control. And the king's or the president's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Wouldn't it be amazing this morning that if we could say that the heart of President Trump is in the hand of the Lord? Well, according to the Word of God, it is. But yet, even as Christians, sometimes it's so hard for us to believe the Word of God. Can I get an amen this morning? We know what the Word of God says, and oftentimes we can quote it, but how many understand living it and believing it is a whole nother level? How many would say amen this morning? Oh, my Lord, help us not to just know the Word, but to believe the Word. Amen. You see, perhaps we would tend to believe this verse more if the president was a good Christian. Amen? But the Bible doesn't make that stipulation, does it? That's not a requirement for this verse to be true. So what if the heart of kings and presidents are really in the hand of God? No matter who they are, Democrats, Republicans, independents, wigwags, whatever they are, tea parties. Doesn't matter, because the word of God is true. How many would say amen? You see, first of all, I believe we would ask ourselves a question this morning when we begin to think about all this and contemplate it. Does God allow evil kings and evil presidents to come to power? And before you blurt out an answer this morning, just think about it for a moment. Does God allow evil kings and evil presidents to come to power? I would say yes. I would say yes, that God does allow evil kings and presidents and evil kingdoms, and yes, perhaps even evil dictators to come to power. And the reason being is perhaps it might be God's judgment upon a nation, or it might be to simply give the people what they want. How many understand the children of Israel begged for a king for so long that God finally said, okay, listen, you know what? I'm going to give you what you want. They're looking around at all these other nations and all these other peoples, and they have a king, and the Lord's trying to tell them, listen, I'm your king. You don't need a king. But how many know sometimes God just gets tired of listening to us, and he just gives us what we want? How many know that's the truth, whether it's good for us or not? But ultimately, no matter what, we know that God is in control. How many would say amen this morning? Look at this in Romans chapter 13, verses number 1 and 2. Romans 13, 1 and 2. It says, let every soul, everybody say every soul. That means all of us. That includes everybody. There's no exception to the rule. Let every soul be subject. Everybody say be subject. What does that mean, be subject? Come under to, submitted to, accountable, come under authority. Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. Watch this now, for there is no power. Everybody say no power. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are what? Are ordained of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Now, we know how the church thinks. We, for the most part, we know how the church votes. And, you know, if a Republican's in office, we think, well, you know, God's in control. And if somebody else is in office, then God ain't in control. No, can I tell you, God is in control all the time. All the time. All the time. He's large and in charge. And the devil, as we know him, he might be the lowercase g god of this world. But can I tell you, he has no more power than what God allows him. How many would say amen? He has him on a very short leash this morning. And I tell you what, God has everything under control. The powers that be are ordained of God. Verse number 2 in Romans here. Whosoever therefore resists the power, resists the ordinance of God. How many understand our very structure of government comes from the Bible? Where did man get his ideas for governments and laws and so on and so forth? The Bible, the Word of God. Whosoever therefore resists the power, resists the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive unto themselves what? Judgment, damnation. Wow. That's pretty clear, isn't it? So we see here from the Word of God that all authority is ordained by God. Now, when we think about that, the day and age we live in, the generation where anything goes and there's so much rebellion and there's so much lawlessness, do you know that there is a close link between lawlessness and rebellion and sin? It all goes together. The more sinful our world gets, the more lawless we become. How many remember the good old days when you could just leave your house unlocked? You could definitely leave your car doors unlocked. But how many know you don't dare do that today? Why? Because of sin. Sin produces lawlessness. And that is exactly a description of the day and age in which we live. Many are resisting the powers thereof. Authority. How many? I've never seen a day like this where nobody wants to come under authority anymore. It's like, don't tell me what to do. And I get that to a certain extent because I'm a little bit like that myself. I'm a little rebellious. And a little rebellion, I think, is good because you can be a little stubborn. But how many understand you got to know when to say when, honey? You got to understand that sometimes you just got to do the right thing. You just got to come under authority. Unless you want to pay the consequences. How many understand there's a price to pay if you want to disobey the law? If you want to run out here about 90 miles an hour on Woodlawn this afternoon, go ahead, but expect a ticket to follow sometime, right? Unless you get away with it. And if you get away with it, well, that's fine, but just don't think you'll get away with it next time, right? Lawlessness, sin, disobedience, rebellion, it all goes together, doesn't it? It's a sign of our times in which we live. But all authority is ordained by God. And that's why when the sinner man sees authority, they resist it because it reminds them of a holy God. Amen. You ever thought about that? You ever thought about why everybody hates the police? It's because they represent authority. Did I say that right? The police? The po-po? Yeah. Shark in the water, phone's off the hook. I've been locked up way too long. You got to understand, I've worked at a prison for 28 years. But why do we resist authority? It's our sinful nature. It's our sinful nature. Why do we resist mom and dad? Why do we resist what our pastor has to say? Or as kids, why do we resist what the Sunday school teacher has to say? Because sin comes natural to the flesh. Have you noticed you don't have to teach your kids how to sin? You don't have to teach your kids how to backtalk? Come on. It just comes natural. Look at your neighbor and say, sin comes natural. Yeah, it just comes natural because we're sinners. But all authority is ordained by God. And that's why the Bible says, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and render unto God what is God's. As Christians, how many believe that we are to obey the laws of the land? Amen. Amen? Let me say this. The only time we don't have to obey is if it blatantly, disrespectfully, obviously goes against the word of God. In all other times, we are to obey. We are to comply. But can I tell you, there are some times when we have an exception. For an example of this, let's go to the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 3, a very familiar story, a story that we all heard growing up in Sunday school. Daniel chapter 3. Verse number 8. Therefore, at that time, certain Chaldeans came forward and accused the Jews. They spoke and said to King Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree that everyone who hears the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, and symphony with all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the gold image. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Now there are certain Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not paid due regard to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the gold image which you have set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in rage and fury, gave the command to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying to them, Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the gold image which I have set up? Now, if you are ready at the time you hear the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, and symphony with all kinds of music, and you fall down and worship the image which I have made, good. But if you do not worship, you shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you from my hands? Boy, did he ever ask a loaded question right there. He had no idea what he was asking for. Verse number 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. How many know it's good to know what your God can do? Amen. Now, when you start talking like this, I would suggest that you know God. That you just don't know about him. That you just don't have read about him, but you know him on a personal, intimate relationship. How many would say amen? Verse number 18. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. Now, wait a minute. That just takes it to a whole nother level right there. Because first of all, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego say, you know what? If God delivers us, let him be God. But they go on to say, but you know what? If he doesn't, if we end up burning up in the fiery furnace, we still going to serve God. Can somebody say amen? Kind of sounds like an old guy I know by the name of Job. Said, though you slay me, yet will I serve you. How many know you got to have a made up mind? You got to have a made up mind. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury, and the expression on his face changed toward Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He spoke and commanded that the heat of the furnace seven times more than it usually was heated. And he commanded certain mighty men of valor who were in his army to bind or to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, their trousers, their turbans, all their other garments, and they were cast in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And therefore, because the king's command was urgent and the furnace was so exceedingly hot, the flame of the fire killed the men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So how many understand? It's a hot furnace. It's a hot fire. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down, bound, into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished, and he rose in haste and spoke, saying to his counselors, did we not cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said to the king, oh, true, king. And how many understand by at this point they're just yes men? They're just going to tell Nebuchadnezzar what he wants to hear at this point because they're so afraid of him. But yeah, you're right. We only threw three in there. But he says, look, he answered, I see four men. And not only do I see four, but they're loose. They're not tied up anymore. And not only are there four, and not only are they loose, but they're walking around in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. How many understand when God doesn't take you away from the fire, he'll take you through the fire? Come on, somebody. My Lord. See, oftentimes, too many times, we're trying to get delivered out of the fire when God's wanting to take us through the fire. But look at this, verse number 25 again. He says, look, I see four men loose. And so they've got all this garb on. They've got probably, you know, thank coverings on their head. They're out in the desert, so on and so forth. And they got all these clothes on. But the only thing that was burnt off of them were the things that bound them. How many understand the fire of God is a good thing? The fire of God doesn't want to burn you. It wants to consume you. And the only thing that's going to fall off is the stuff you didn't need that I didn't need in the first place. Can somebody say amen? He says, look, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire. They're not hurt. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Then Nebuchadnezzar went near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spoke, saying, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out and come here. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came from the midst of the fire. And the satraps and the administrators, the governors, the kings, the counselors gathered together. And they saw these men on whose body the fire had no power over. Come on, somebody. Watch this. The hair of their head was not singed, nor were their garments affected, and the smell of fire was not on them. My Lord, have mercy. They didn't even smell like smoke. Come on, somebody. Woo, Jesus. Isn't that just like our God? Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. And they have frustrated the king's word and yielded their bodies that they should not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree." Boy, that sounds like our president, doesn't it? Making all kind of executive orders. "Therefore, I make a decree that any people, nation, or language which speaks anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made an ash heap, because there is no other God who can deliver like this." Watch this now. "Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon." Can somebody say praise the Lord this morning? Can I tell you right now, what doesn't kill you will only make you stronger, honey. Come on, if you will stay faithful, if you will stay resolved, listen, what the devil meant to kill you with, God will use to promote you with it. Can somebody say amen? Ooh, look at your neighbor and tell him, "I'm getting promoted in 2017. I'm getting promoted. I'm getting promoted this year." What an amazing story we have read in your hearing this morning. We see here from the three Hebrew children, as they are known, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that there is a time to comply, but there's also a time to defy. Hello? There's a time to comply, but there's a time to defy. And when Nebuchadnezzar was king, the three Hebrew children proved that God was still on the throne. Can somebody say amen this morning? So the powers that be are ordained of God. And when someone is in power, when someone is in authority, then what are you and I as the church, what are we supposed to do? The answer is found here in 1 Timothy. Let's look at it. 1 Timothy chapter number 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2 verses 1 and 2. "Therefore," the Apostle Paul speaking to his young son in the faith, Timothy, "therefore I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men." Everybody say all men. Not some, not most, not the Republicans, not the Democrats, not white, not black, not red, not yellow, not the ones we like, but all men. "Thanks be made for all men, for things, for kings or presidents and all who are in authority." And why is that? "That we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and reverence." Now listen, it's your God-given right, it's your American right, if you don't like President Trump and if you don't agree with him. But I tell you what I can't stand is when I read something or when I hear something about people wanting him to fail. Honey, he is our president. Why would you want our president to fail? As much as I disliked President Obama and did not hardly agree with anything he did, I did not want to see him fail. I did my best to pray for that man. And that is our responsibility as the church, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and reverence. So as the church, we are to lift up everyone who is in authority or leadership. Amen. We are to lift them up in prayer. Yes, sir. In fact, I believe on a daily basis, how many would say amen? Amen. But ultimately, God is in control. We know that. He's the God of the universe. But yet, it does matter who is in authority. And we can just make a blanket statement and say, well, it doesn't matter, because God is in control. But I believe it does matter. Watch this. Proverbs chapter 29, verse number 2. I believe we can prove by the word of God this morning that it does matter who's president, who's king, who's in authority, who's in power. Proverbs 29, verse number 2. When the righteous are in authority, the people what? The people rejoice. But when a wicked man rules, the people groan. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice, but when a wicked man rules, the people groan. So righteousness always commands a blessing. Righteousness is a right standing with God. Righteousness is what God does for us, or what God did for us through his Son, the cross, his blood, so on and so forth. Righteousness is what God does for us. Holiness is what we do for him. How many would say amen? But righteousness always commands a blessing. Righteousness simply means a right standing with God. But sin will always produce a curse. And that's so important for us to know, because it doesn't matter if it's a nation, if it's a certain group of people, if it's a family, if it's an individual, sin will always produce a curse. Look at this in Proverbs chapter 14, verse number 34. How many love our nation? How many are praying for our country, our president? Amen. How many understand we need to use our freedom to defend our freedom? How many understand freedom isn't free? But it has cost so many thousands and thousands the ultimate sacrifice. But look at this, Proverbs 14:34. Righteousness does what? Righteousness exalts or builds up, makes good, lifts up. Righteousness exalts a nation. But sin is a reproach to any people. In other words, there's no exceptions to this rule. Doesn't matter who we are. Doesn't matter if it's talking about a real nation in the natural sense, or if it's talking about a church or a person or a family. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Now, the bad thing about sin is this. How many understand, man, I say this with tongue in cheek, but how many understand we can get away with sin for a certain amount of time? And that's the bad thing, if there is a bad thing about grace, is the fact that we can get away with sin for a certain time. And we've got to be so careful about that, because how many understand we can't take the grace of God for granted? We can't make grace a disgrace. And just because God extends grace to us doesn't mean that we just go out and sin even the more. That's not grace at all, because grace is not only the forgiveness of our sin and the pardon of our sin, but how many know grace is actually the enabler to have power to live over sin? Can somebody say amen? That's what real grace is about. So righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Righteous living will always cause good things to happen. Now, that's not to say that the devil's not going to fight you. We were already talking about that this morning. If you're trying to live for God and trying to do the right thing, how many understand the devil hates your guts? And he's going to try to hit you with everything plus the kitchen sink. Sickness, infirmity, financial, whatever it is, he's going to try to get you. But in the long run, we know that it pays off to be right. How many would say amen? Do you believe that? Listen, if I didn't believe that, I wouldn't be here this morning. I wouldn't be that. Righteousness will cause good things to happen, but sin will always bring calamity. That's why the Bible says the wages, or the paycheck of sin, is what? Death. Now, it might not be immediate death, but eventually it will be death. Sin will not always bring an immediate response from God, but habitual, repeated, unrepented sin will bring a curse upon our lives. How many believe that to be true this morning? It's true. It's true. We can find it to be true throughout the Word of God so many times. Now, quickly, I want to talk here about President Trump for just a little bit. And we know that President Trump is very anti-establishment. He's very uncanny, uncouth. I'm trying to be nice here. He's very unorthodox, very brash, very bold. Appears to be somewhat arrogant. I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt here. Come on, somebody. He's our president. Supposedly a young Christian. So how much more should we be praying for him?
Amen. Right?
But the entire election of Donald Trump as our new president was quite the event. How many would say amen? It was unprecedented. Unprecedented. It was just, obviously, those who were not living under a rock for the last year, you understand that this was just a major event. And I will admit that in the primary, I did not vote for Donald Trump. I did not vote for him. In the general election, I did. I did, but not in the primary. But who is this man that we now call president? Very familiar man, but yet, do we really know him? He's grown up among us as one of our own. And let me say this, I forgot to write this down, but let me say it while I'm remembering it. President Trump's grandparents were involved in the Great Revival over in Wales. Isn't that something? And so I must admit, I would have never thought that Donald Trump would someday be our president. I never thought the choice would come between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, I promise you that. But I love what Brother Ken said the other night. If God spoke through a donkey, then he can use President Trump. I believe that. Now, is that to say that I agree with everything he says or does? Or absolutely not. Absolutely not. Does it mean that I believe President Trump is some great Christian? No, it doesn't. I hope and pray that what I've heard from other Christian leaders is true, what they're saying about him. But the verdict is still out about our new president, and time will tell. Now, some have compared our new president to the ancient Persian king Cyrus. How many remember old King Cyrus from the Old Testament? Very interesting story, very interesting man. And some believe that Trump is going to be used for the good of America and even the good of the church, just as Cyrus was used for the good of the Jewish people, even though Cyrus was a pagan king. Now think about that. Think about that. Let's go to Isaiah here real quick, and we'll just look at a couple things. The Old Testament prophet Isaiah. Chapter number 45, beginning reading in verse number 1. The word of the Lord come through the Old Testament prophet and said this. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus. Wow, think about that. The Lord says you're anointed, whose right hand I have held to subdue nations before him and loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors so that the gates will not be shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places, that you may know that I, the Lord, who call you by name, am the God of Israel. For Jacob, my servant's sake, and Israel, my elect, I have even called you by your name. I have named you, though you have not known me. Come on, somebody, you just missed a good place to shout right there. I have named you, though you have not known me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God besides me. I will gird you, though you have not known me. Wow. Wow. So, yes, if God can use a pagan king called Cyrus, I believe God can use a man by the name of Donald J. Trump. How many would say amen? Amen. I believe that. Now, quickly, let me just kind of throw some numbers at you here. We all know that on May the 14th, 2018, a date yet to come, Israel will have officially been regathered in fulfillment of Bible prophecy for exactly 70 years. May the 14th, 1948, the state of Israel was reinstated as a nation. And we will celebrate that 70th year anniversary on May the 14th, 2018. Now, in 70 AD, another 70. Notice here the play on numbers. In 70 AD, Israel was destroyed by the Romans, and the temple stones toppled to the ground exactly as Jesus said it would happen. Now, the only reason I bring all of this up is because we know that God is a God of divine order, and He is a God of not only wonders, but He's a God of numbers. Hello? All right. He's not only a God of wonders, but He's a God of numbers. Look at this in Daniel chapter 9, verse number 2. Throwing a little Bible prophecy at you here this morning. Daniel 9, 2. In the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by the books the number. Everybody say the number. The number of the years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet that he would accomplish. Everybody say accomplish. That he would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. So obviously, I believe that 70 is a very important number. How many would say amen? It's got to be. 70 has to be an important number. Okay, now let's go to the Old Testament prophet, Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 25, verses 11 and 12. And this whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon. How many years? 70 years. Okay, so it's not just 70 AD, but it's 70 years. Then it will come to pass when 70 years are what? Are completed. Okay, now let's just stop right there. Remember in Matthew 24 when Jesus says, when you see all these signs compassed about, look up for redemption draweth nigh. When you see the fig tree restored, when you see the nation of Israel restored, know this, that this generation shall not pass until all these things become fulfilled. Somebody just go ahead and do the math. 1948 plus 70, just go ahead and do the math in your head. Verse number 12, then it will come to pass when 70 years are completed that I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation, the land of the Chaldeans, for their iniquity, says the Lord, and I will make it a perpetual desolation. Wow. That kind of sounds dramatic. That kind of sounds final. That kind of sounds like the end. That kind of sounds like the tribulation. Come on, somebody. That kind of sounds like Armageddon. You say, Pastor Steve, are we living that close? Yes, I believe we are. I believe we are. So it's obvious that 70 is a very important number. But after that, after Daniel has to digest that bombshell, he is then visited by the angel Gabriel, who gives Daniel his own shocking prophecy of the 70 weeks of years. Once again, we see another 70, but this time it's a 70 weeks of years. And just to make a long story short, can I tell you all of that prophecy, the 70 weeks of years, has been fulfilled except for the last week or the 7-year period known as the time of Jacob's trouble. The only thing we have left is the rapture of the church, whenever it's going to happen, and the great tribulation. That's the only thing we got left to look forward to. Wow. Wow. It's found here in the book of Jeremiah, and then mentioned by Jesus in Matthew chapter 24 as the time of great tribulation. Look at it quickly with me. Jeremiah chapter 30, verse number 7. Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble. But he shall be saved out of it. So are we going through it or not? I don't know. I think it would pay to be ready just in case the rapture happens before the tribulation. Matthew 24:21, look at this. For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. So we know that seven is God's number. How many would say amen? We understand. I don't have time to get into it. Six is man's number. We know that the mark of the beast is 666, but seven is God's number. You ever wonder why, you know, Las Vegas, whatever the gamblers call seven, lucky seven? It's because it's God's number. It's God's number. God created the earth in 6 days, but on the seventh day, or the Sabbath, he rested. So then, with all this in mind, 70 years, the number seven, we take Donald Trump. He was born on June the 14th, 1946. Okay, everybody ready to do their math? And we know that Mr. Trump was 70 years old when he was elected president. That makes Donald Trump the oldest person ever to be elected president of the United States. Just a few months older than Ronald Reagan. But it doesn't stop there. On Friday, January 20th, 2017, just last month, President Trump was inaugurated as our 45th president. But then, on the very next day, which was Saturday, January 21st, 2017, his first full day in office, his first full day as president, does anybody want to guess how old Donald Trump was? He was 70 years, 7 months, and 7 days old. Somebody tell me God doesn't know what he's doing. Come on. Come on. Now, I got a little confession right here. Because many Christians seen it. They prophesied it. It was all over the internet. It was all over YouTube. I mean, you could just pull up hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of videos about Christians saying, God told me President Trump's going to... And this is before the election. That Trump's going to get in. Trump's going to get in. He's da-da-da-da-da. I'm like... Okay, and you can even go and Google Kim Clement, who has just recently passed away, but a mighty man of God, somewhat controversial, but I believe a mighty man of God, and I believe he was a prophet. He prophesied back in, I want to say, 2007, 2008, about Trump getting in office, and it's amazing, because he calls him by name. He says so many crazy things about it, and it's just like, wow. But on his first full day in office, Donald Trump was 70 years, 7 months, and 7 days old. Wow. And not only that, but Donald Trump beat out 16 other competitors to win the Republican nomination, which would make him candidate number 17. Now, Donald Trump's many campaign promises was that he was going to move the U.S. Embassy in Israel from its current location in Tel Aviv to its new location in Jerusalem. Let me give you some quick history about this, and we'll fly through this real quick. But according to the Jerusalem Embassy Relocation Act of 1995, in October 1995, the Senate and the House adopted the Jerusalem Embassy Relocation Act, stating that the U.S. Embassy should be moved from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem no later than May 31st, 1999. So from 95 to 99. Well, guess what? It never happened. Never happened. But included in the measure, however, was a stipulation allowing the president to issue a waiver every 6 months to keep the embassy in Tel Aviv if he determined and reported to Congress that such a delay was necessary to protect the national security interests of the United States. So then, to make a long story short, we fast forward to President Barack Obama's presidency. Once again, he continued to take advantage of this waiver. And President Obama issued his final waiver preventing the move during his administration on December 1st, 2016. So then, if President Trump keeps his campaign promise and moves the U.S. Embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, we could be looking at the war of Psalms 83 being fulfilled. Let's look at it real quick. Psalms chapter 83, verse number 4 and 5. So let me say this. I'm not this huge Trump fan that thinks Trump is the greatest thing since sliced bread. He's going to do some great things for this country. He's going to do some great things for the church. But listen, he's also going to take us into some things that's going to lead to the end. And it might just be World War III. Okay? Psalms 83, chapter 4 and 5. They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be remembered no more. For they have consulted together with one consent. They form a confederacy against you. Now listen, church. We plainly understand the word of God, right? That the Bible says that if we bless the nation of Israel, we will be blessed. But if we curse them, then we will be cursed. So listen, we've got to pray for our president that he keeps his campaign promise, that he moves the U.S. Embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, and that he promises, or he does what he's promised that he will do, and he will be a keeper of the nation of Israel. How many would say amen? Amen. So obviously, we are living in the last of the last days. And it doesn't really matter what we think about President Trump, whether we like him or don't like him, whether we voted or not voted for him. The fact is that he's in office, and now we need to pray for him. Now we need to pray for him because two things right here. First of all, there's never been a time like this. Second, there's never been a president like this. This man is on a mission. You can tell it. You can see it in his eyes. He's on a mission. In fact, I'm beginning to think he believes he's called by God to do this. So listen, we need to watch the news. We need to stay informed. We need to stay prayed up because I promise you, things are going to happen and things are going to happen fast. And you say, well, you know, I've heard this all my life. No, listen. The wheels of God grind slow, but they grind sure. And God will seemingly take forever just to do something suddenly. And honey, if you don't believe things are about to happen fast, just watch and see what's going to happen and transpire by the end of 2017. It's going to make your head spin, I promise you. All the things we're going to see. It's going to be a crazy year, a year like none other. We are living in the last of the last days. And yes, I do believe God has raised up a man by the name of Donald John Trump to play a very important role in all of this. And church, if we have ever prayed for our nation, if we have ever prayed for our president, we need to do it now. If we have ever did what we've been called to do, we need to do it now. Now, in closing, let me say this. And praise team, you can come, so I'll quit. But I know, you know, I hear everything just like you do. And I try to weigh it balancedly. I try to take it all in and weigh it. And I know that there are those who say that President Trump is just using the church. He's just using the Christian vote. He's just telling us what we want to hear so he would get elected. And maybe he is, or maybe he's not. But my thinking is this. Instead of Trump using God and religion, What if God is using Trump? All them Christians, they're so gullible, you tell them anything and they'll believe it. You know, let me give you that. I'll quit. But let me give you that. Let's just say Donald Trump started this out and he felt it in his whatever. He's like, you know what? I'm going to play my cards right. I think America's ready for a change. I'm going to play the church card. Right? Well, guess what? We played the Trump card. Anyway, okay. Can I just go ahead and say it? Yeah, let me just go ahead and say it. Okay, Obama used the race card. Hillary used the sex card, female. And we used the Trump card. Anyway, let's just say Trump started out on this with all the bad motives in the world. He's seen it coming. He's like, you know what? America's ready for a change. I'm gonna appear as a Christian. I'm going to say all the right things. I'm going to let the Christians lay hands on me. I'm going to let them anoint me. And I'm going to be elected the next president of the United States. You know what? Even if that was his motive, God can still use that. What Satan meant for evil, God can turn around for the good. So listen, church. It would not surprise me whatsoever if President Trump is our last president. Last president. We are that close to the end. That's why I believe things are so hard. That's why I believe we have battled like we have battled. Anybody battled the last year, the last 6 months, the last, yeah. So maybe it's not so much that Trump's using us, but God's using him. But ultimately, whatever we think of President Trump, we are commanded by the Word of God to pray for him. And our opening text this morning told us that the heart of the king, or the heart of the president, is in the hand of the Lord. Church, I don't know about you, but I believe it's time to rise and shine. I believe it's time for us to do what God has called us to do. Stand with me, if you would, please. Father, we thank you for truth. We thank you for revelation.
Yes, we do, Lord.
God, we thank you that we can discern the signs of the time. Lord, we know that we are living at the end of the end, that we are living in the last of the last days. And Lord, when we think about this 70-year period of May the 14th, 1948, Lord, we look ahead to that date of May the 14th, 2018. Father, it's not very far off at all. And God, we have just read in your word where you said the 70 years will be accomplished. And so, Lord, make us ready today. Lord, open the eyes of our understanding to see, to perceive, to understand, to comprehend. Lord, I pray for a spirit of revelation, of seeing and knowing, that we would perceive and discern. God, that you would remove the scales from our eyes, that you would remove the sin and the weight that so easily besets us, that we may run with patience the race that is set before us. For he is able to keep that unto the end against that day which he has promised us. We thank you and we praise you. Father, I pray that we would be encouraged by the hearing of your word this morning. For Lord, the greatest encouragement that we can give is, look up, for our redemption draweth nigh. And we say, as the Spirit is the bride, they cry, come quickly unto you. And we just thank you and we praise you for it in Jesus' name. Won't you come with me and let's just stand in the altar and let's just worship God as we close out the service today. Come on.